Hey, my name is Kelly Starrett.
I'm Carl Paoli.
We want to talk about more functional and more effective box jumping.
That's right.
So what we're going to do is we're going to break this down into a few pieces. One is starting off with what we think are kind of some of the real problems that we typically see, how to kind of maximize the efficiency of this with some movement preparation, and then Carl is going to blow your mind with some effective tips about efficiency and scoring high. Is that right?
That's right.
Okay. So here's the first piece, is that we need people to understand is that the jumping and landing mechanic is the same no matter what you're doing. And that we are pretty good at identifying that a rounded back position is not okay to deadlift in. We understand that, you know, breaking, pushing overhead is not an okay position. We want people to understand the same thing is when they jump and land. And that if I'm up on the box, knees are collapsed, and what's happening a lot is that the Achilles is now collapsed. My foot has collapsed in, my Achilles is pulling off axis. And as I jump back down, if the same thing happens, then I've loaded and my Achilles and all my calf isn't working in a good position. So a lot of what we're gonna do is prep is making sure that we're just landing in a simple straight foot forward position with the Achilles being able to track straight over what we think is basically a balanced arch. And this is the chief problem. Now, Carl will talk about the difference real quick between jumping and what we see on the box jump and why this is important.
I think what's happening here is basically we're dealing with little kids right in the playground. When we hear 3-2-1 go and there's a lot of box jumps and there's jumping and landing involved and we're just playing, we're like dealing with kids. So in the development of jumping and landing or these basic mechanics, what we want to do is we want to avoid these bad things from happening. And sometimes you can coach someone on it or guide them and tell them, hey, this is a bad position, but for some reason they just can't fix it. So I use this terminology of a blocking movement, and a blocking movement is a very basic way of saying, hey, I'm going to set a movement standard that's going to force you to not get into a bad position, right? So that movement standard that we talk about is the first one for jumping and landing is feet together. If my feet are together and I just do this very basic test, and Kelly, you can do this too, feet together, ankles together, big toe together. If I bend over, put my hands flat on the ground, and I allow myself to bend my knees just a little bit, but keep my hips up high, what I notice is that immediately my knees go out and I create that stable ankle, that stable arch, and what we think is the most optimal position to apply efficient force, right?
That's right.
So starting with your feet together is a great place to be, and this is what we do with the kids. We just say, hey, if you're gonna jump and land, I want you to try to jump and land with your feet together. Or just can you jump with feet separate and land with feet together? Just a simple thing like that helps you get into this kind of a high volume box jump.
If I'm a big guy jumping up and down and my force is oblique, or I'm getting off axial loading, this is where I tend to see me giving away a lot of force and dumping a lot of torque, and it's really inefficient.
Totally. So what we're trying to do is we're trying to show you a simple way of prepping for this thing to A, get your body in a good position to move, and then maybe the nervous system prime before we get into some work. So here's the first thing. If my feet are together on the ground, that's easy to be in. If I bend over and I load up the hip and get the hamstrings involved, my knees automatically cave out, the toes stay on the ground, I get that nice neutral position, I'm grabbing the ground, I'm in a good place. Now the problem is when my feet release from the ground and all of a sudden I don't have that connection, I have some sort of loss. And then how do I reclaim that loss? Well, that's the hard part. And so we need to...
That's the landing.
Yeah, that's the landing.
All right, okay.
Right? That's the hard part. So how do we do that? With our kids, there's a very simple way of doing it. In gymnastics, we talk about a lot of rolling. So a way of doing it is saying, okay, go feet together. Let's just go ahead and squat down with the knees out. Can you roll back, come back to that same position, and meet with your feet in a good place where you're not landing and having this business going? We see that a lot. And I think that's a classic thing that we see on a daily basis, not just in box jumps, but also in Olympic weightlifting.
No, I know what you're talking about.
You don't know what I'm talking about, right? So this is what we want to do. We want to talk about chasing. And when we talk about chasing, it's basically saying, hey, let's bring everything into the midline. Let's connect everything. Let's wind it up and see how we can connect the dots by saying, hey, Kelly, he's going to prime us. He's going to get into a better position. And here are the progressions to kind of put it all together.
Perfect.
Correct?
So one of the things that we see regularly is that our athletes are exposed to lots of running. That I'm in these neutral balance running positions, and then my foot is going down, I land ball of foot, heel kisses, and I'm back up to position.
Right.
Same thing happens in my double unders. That some people block this position.
Yeah.
Guys like Chris Spieler knees are right underneath his hips and right underneath the shoulders, very relaxed, but still, every time he lands, he doesn't collapse. Toes just on, nice and relaxed, right? The problem is, what happens when I take this nice jumping mechanic and then start tipping it forward? This is where we start to see problems, right? So what happens then in the difference between the kind of upright torso-ness that happens when my normal jumping, when I come forward, is that the demand of the ankle starts to go through the roof. And this is where the system sort of falls apart. Is that most people have enough range in this mid-range, we're all looking good, but then as soon as I start to have to inclinate my torso forward a little bit, and you'll notice that when Carl did that position, go ahead and roll back up again. Knees are forward, ankles out, and the corner that we're missing is not abject knee over toe. This puts him necessarily in a collapsed ankle position. It's the knee out that allows him to kind of stabilize. And the corner that we're missing then is not just calf range with the leg straight, but do I have enough calf range to be in these jumping stable positions? So that's something we've got to keep an eye on to mobilize as we kind of work through this problem. Okay?
Perfect.
So
that's the first piece, addressing ankle. If we're just jumping straight up and down, we're vertical, but if we're jumping onto a box, we're leaning forward.
So I've got to have to think some ankle prep. I got some ideas.
Right, okay. So perfect. So Kelly's got your back on that, and that's what we're going to work on. Now, second thing is, we need the hips working, we need the shoulders working a little bit. In gymnastics, when we talk about jumping and landing or jumping, we just say, hey, if your arms are your wings, your spine is your transmission, and your hips are your main power generator. So in athletic performance a little bit, what we do is we work backwards. Instead of starting with the main power generator, we're gonna start with a smaller mover, so it's a little bit more simple. What we do is we just say arms up, we can get a little fancy and turn the hands out a little bit, bam, and you would say, oh, this is internal rotation, this is bad for the shoulder, but because you're not connected up top, what you're doing is you're externally rotating the shoulder and then you're bringing the thumb in, and what are you creating? A little torque, right?
More importantly, if I'm wrong, my hands are coming down when I jump, so it preloads me to be in a stable position for the shoulder and the jumping position,
correct.
Right?
Okay. Correct. So what we're going into is just, can you swing your arms down and back up? What happens here is, Kelly will tell you this, is that as the shoulder goes into extension, what happens? We need internal rotation.
The shoulder joint becomes stable,
right.
And this becomes a powerful mechanism. This is why I don't jump and dunk a basketball out here.
Right.
Right? So you're asking me to jump with like this on my box jumps?
No, I'm just saying that this is a good way of prepping the shoulder to just get that shoulder going with you. And then we're gonna work at mid-range and we're gonna bend the arms a little bit. And this is where we're gonna be jumping. And you'll see that some people do the little butterfly arm, but it always goes from mid-range flexion, mid-range extension. And that's where we wanna live.
And if I'm missing this range, if I can't reload, to quick jump back up, because this is a big driver of my force.
Correct.
So we'll see, then my elbows fly out, then I lose that position and now I've lost my carriage and I become disorganized through the trunk, which means that I now am gimballing up and down off the box. I'm
correct.
Falling, it's like pushing a noodle, which is a problem when I'm tired because I'm frankly a tiny dancer.
Okay, that's right. So that being said, we're saying that as you move your arms, you want to have mobility in the shoulder, you want to have good internal rotation so you can go into extension, correct?
Correct.
That you want your thoracic spine to be fairly mobile, because otherwise we're gonna see all this neck problem going and we're gonna look a little funky. And even if it's minimal and it's under no load, it's gonna give away a lot, right?
That's right. So, okay, so we're gonna put that on our list.
Yeah.
We've gotta clean up the shoulder. Okay, I've got that.
Perfect.
Now, one of the big deals that I see is that I notice that people end up really short in the hip on these things.
Correct.
And that when I'm short in the hip, that tends to overextend me. And that if I'm overextended because I'm short in the hip, jumping up and down, my knees tend to wobble, and now my foot tends to kind of collapse a little bit more.
Correct.
And I always see limited range of calf always goes along with limited range of motion of the hip.
Very, very right.
Okay, so what does that mean then when you're talking about jumping?
So basically what's happening is if we understand this finishing position, the arm, the rest of the body is going to follow, and we're going to guarantee that we're blocking all these bad things from happening.
Wait a minute. The movement standard then is nice because I get to stand up on the box and I have to pause.
You have to finish.
And that finish sets me up to the exact same position. So it blocks me from ending up and landing and starting again in a wretched position.
That's correct.
So if I stand up and lock the hip out, then I'm automatically guaranteed that I'm going to start again.
Right. And this is Kelly's whole point of getting organized over and over again, right? So we get organized from the jump, we get organized at the top. So they're just setting us up for success. This
great.
Is awesome.
Fantastic.
Right? So now, hip involved. If I can swing my arms, and that's no problem, Can I involve my hip in this thing? Can I dip and drive? And this is where it gets tricky. A lot of people, when they swing their arms and try to dip, this is what happens. Their eyes drop, they're looking down, and now we don't have access to a lot of stuff and we're not gonna get the direction we want. So how do we work on this and keep our chest up and still driving in the right direction, but without having those major faults where we get into overextension, the neck breaks, the shoulder breaks? Well, that's where Kelly comes in with his magic and he gives us a little hip mode.
Great, so we're gonna put that on our list. We've gotta be able to open up the front of the hip a little bit more effectively so they don't end up in this broken, wretched position. That I can open up the hip and then reload and still come to that full hip extension at the top of the box. Okay, so I've got a pretty good idea of the things that I need to do. Let's take you through those pieces and then you can show me some efficiency.
Sounds
on the
perfect.
Box because
perfect.
Frankly, I need the help.
That's right.
I'm going for Rory. Here we go. So let's start from the top down like we talked.
Or yep.
We did bottom up. So let's talk about the ankle first.
Yeah. So okay. Start with the ankle.
So a couple things that we see is that athletes are very stiff in that calf. That calf takes lots and lots of abuse and it gets very, very stiff. And one of the ways that's an easy way that isn't a kind of a pregame stretch, because everyone's probably got a good calf stretch, is that we can think about dealing with muscle stiffness. One of my favorite ways to do this is to set up a barbell and then just roll side to side. Now, if I know that I'm gonna compete in the afternoon, I'll actually get a dose of mobility work or prep work earlier in the day. It feels like it sets up my tissues to be faster. So if I know I'm competing at 5 o'clock, I'll go ahead and hit this maybe like 10 o'clock if I can do it, because it makes it easier for me to reclaim those positions. But even just spending 2 or 3 minutes grinding back and forth, and you'll probably feel a little chunky section in there. I want you to smash that. And we call this barbell smashing. It's a very technical term for smashing. I can reach forward, I can do this kind of floss, but what I'm trying to do is not stretch, I'm trying to deal with muscle stiffness. And so I can just roll, and when I find something ugly, I'm just gonna hang on it back and forth, and then just keep working my way up. Where we typically see people having problems, it's not high up in the calf, it's in this distal part of the calf, kind of in this big common tendon. This is the area that gets stiff, and that's the area I'm gonna focus on with my stiffness barbell stuff. Second piece is we're gonna take the systems approach. We're gonna work on ankle capsule. We have two ways to deal with this. The band will keep me from impinging if I turn it this way. So I'm gonna load this up, and then without letting my ankle collapse in, I'm gonna drive my ankle out, maintaining this neutral position. What ends up happening is if we're missing range, we're gonna have to go around the range, and now my Achilles is in a wretched position to receive any kind of load, jumping, landing, whatever we're doing. So I'm gonna press into these corners. I can even squat down, grind back and forth. Look, doesn't this look like the same positions we're always in anyway for pistols? So I'm gonna just hang out and try to open up the capsule by spending a minute or so grinding back and forth. I'll flip directions, put a little bit more load in, and repeat the same process. Foot straight, grinding back and forth. And I can do it either standing up or down, but really trying to make sure I have full and good ankle range of motion before I prep this, because I'm gonna be jumping. I'm a big guy.
Right.
Right?
Right.
Okay, so let's take up to the shoulder. Carl was talking about being effectively able to jump without having to compensate. The easiest, quickest way is to actually mobilize at the position of restriction. So I reach up, internally rotate, grab the bar, shoulders back, and then just open that up. Oh, that's terrible. I should be better at this, shouldn't I? So this is one of those ideas that I'm just gonna hang out and exaggerate exactly the position I'm gonna be required to be in. Dropping the shoulder down, contract and relax if you want, but just open this up. What you'll find is that the efficiency of being able to swing that arm into a better position and be tight and kind of quiet makes a big difference. Lastly, if you're short in the hip, then you're gonna have to have more knee forward. That means I'm gonna require more ankle range of motion. I wanna use my ankle range of motion for jumping, not to compensate for my crappy hip. So one of the easiest ways we know to address the tight anterior hip, tight front of the hip, is to take a band, put it all the way up in your butt, right in that kind of butt crease there. It's called your gooley. And I put some load into that thing, keeping the butt squeezed. I'm trying to open up. It's basically a Samson stretch on like performance enhancing band stuff, right?
Band steroids.
So what happens is now I'm accounting for the hip capsule and working through range. So this makes it easier for me to start to open up the hip. I can just drop into full extension, capture some of the other pieces. Now the leg is just straighter. I can also just oscillate up and down through range, working on trying to unglue this rectus, because people will claim that their knees get a little hot when they jump. That's a dead giveaway that they're short in the front of the kind of anterior chain musculature. If I have a super friend around, he can stand on that band, whoa, and just oscillate back and forth. That makes it just kind of much worse. And I get this kind of pulse into this end range tissue. Now, I'm going to be able to extend the hip effectively. Whoa, what a difference in terms of how I can achieve this upright position. It makes it easier for me to achieve an upright on the box. I don't have to struggle quite as hard, and that sets me up into a better position when I jump off.
Definitely.
So those would be my kind of three big pieces. I want to make sure, obviously, that I'm taking myself through full range of motion, that I'm doing my normal things, but I'm thinking capsular, I'm thinking stiffness in the calf, I work on the shoulder, and definitely work on the anterior hip, and that's going to make it easier for me to jump and land in good positions.
Right. Perfect.
So what am I thinking on the box, Coach?
Well, on the box now, what happens is that we want to, of course, gain some time there. We want to play this game right. So we want to connect those jumps. Cool thing is that the standard is you have to stop up top and you have to stand tall. So keep it clean, stand tall. The problem is that even if you get organized here, we see a lot of our athletes jump down. Can you go ahead and jump down for me? Just jump down. And they get stuck down there in a bad position. So it's key that just learning how to jump and land from the bottom to bottom. So what I'm talking about is no jumping on the box, just from here. Can you jump? Can you land? And can you land in a good position? So this is what I say. Let's start with our feet together for the jump, just to exaggerate reality, block that movement. Can you jump? And can you land in that same position? If you can do that, you are guaranteeing that you're at least going to be in a fairly good position, good place to go.
Now, your knee out,
yep,
is one way to keep the torso upright.
Correct.
So if I don't have that torque, because Bergner tells me that, knees out allows me to have my torso upright. When I jerk, knees come out, torso upright.
That's correct.
If I don't, then I'm going to be living off my hamstrings, and that means I start to lean forward.
Right.
So I notice you keep shoving your knees out. That seems to make a difference.
That's right. It just keeps my chest upright, right? Which is beautiful.
And if my feet are wider, maybe it doesn't look so exaggerated.
That's where we're going right now.
Right.
Exactly. So you're not going to live here. This is not where we're going to work. So we're just going to separate the feet a little bit. Takes a little bit of tension away. Makes it feel a little more natural. This is your athletic stance, your jumping stance. Now, from here, can you do the same jumping and landing? Can you jump and land in that same position where you don't end up crappy, that the foot placement didn't change, and that it looks the same?
And turn around, so yep. And do the crappy jump for us. Without, if you know. If you even can do the crappy jump.
I don't even know.
Go ahead, just so we can see. Wait, so you can see your Achilles.
Okay.
And hold the bottom position. So in this position, calf is no longer straight up and down. Achilles is really challenged here, and he's blowing off a lot of torque, really ends up challenging that. When he comes back into a neutral position, the calf loads, and it can kind of sort of maximize muscle contraction, soft tissue contraction. The whole system supports that mechanics. So better mechanics is more efficient.
Correct.
And it's safer.
Correct. Now, that being said, are you capable of doing that same jump but landing on the box? This is my box today, a 45-pound plate. Can I jump up and land on that position same way I landed on the floor? And from there, stand up and finish. Easy. Now the problem is, can you jump back and land that same position at the bottom? Most of our athletes, I promise you, cannot do this. So what we do is we say, hey, let's put the feet together on landing on the way down. So at the top, you can separate the feet, stand tall, jump back, feet together. What this is doing is, A, it's giving you a good or better landing mechanics, but it's also increasing a little bit of tension. So it's gonna allow you to do this, rebound off the ground and get back up. So we talk about standing here, come down, feet together, bounce. Feet together, bounce. If my feet are here and I try to bounce, I'm most likely gonna be leaking somewhere and not gonna get that rebound, and I'm gonna miss out on a lot of efficient application of
force. It's called torque dump for a reason.
Totally.
It's not pretty.
Right, it's not pretty. So this is what we say. We say, it's cold at the top, I can hang out for a little bit, I'm chill.
So this
right?
is a good place to rest.
Chill.
That's what you're saying.
Yes. At the bottom, it's hot. Feet together, bounce, boom. Feet together, bounce. If I keep my feet together, what I'm doing now is I'm creating more torque at the bottom, which gives me better application of force, bounces me back up, and then I can go to a place of less torque, which is easier to move to. It's like wind, right? I talk about going from high tension to low tension, or high pressure to low pressure. This is high pressure, feet together. This is low pressure, feet apart. And that's how we get the sequence going. Once I can do it on a 45-pound box, I can go back up here, start from the top, I'm standing tall, bounce back, land.
So
stand.
By squeezing your butt at the top, it's really simple. I don't have to do any work, I don't have to stand up. I just bring my hip through.
Exactly.
Which sounds like my deadlifting cues from my pal, just bring, squeeze your butt, bring your hip through.
Totally.
So I jump to the top, and that automatically sets me up to enter the tunnel into a good position. And this is why coming to a full rest on top of the box is really important, because when we see athletes jump to the top of the box that's organized, then they suddenly enter, and it's very difficult for me to spontaneously organize in the air. This doesn't happen. Does
exactly.
It? Right? So we want to make sure that you understand that top, pause at the top of the box puts the athlete into a good position to be able to jump back to the top of the box.
Exactly. And I think the last thing to address is if you got the coordination, you can kind of use the arm to get back up. I didn't have it on that one, right? But use the arm to get back up. It's just a little arm swing, and that's just enough to get you going. And then the last thing is that because we're landing in this little bit of an angle here and trying to rebound back up, it's key that the heel kind of kisses the ground. So how much tension do we have to have on the body? I say it's enough tension to be able to maintain integrity of the structure, which just means, hey, how efficient are you and how far on that edge can you work? So I think that's the take home piece. If you understand that during warm up, if you can prep with Kelly, then I think you'll have something to do with it.
So you're saying I should practice some technique, make sure that I'm in these good positions, and that if we pause, everything should be balanced, feet are organized, stable positions, ready to go back up?
Correct.
And that I should be able to identify that if I start to collapse and knees are in, or I'm landing like a duck, because that automatically makes it impossible for me. I mean, I can do it, right?
Yeah.
That's a great position. So I'm up here. That's still technical.
Yeah, sure.
But not very efficient.
Not very efficient.
So, idea of feet straight. Jumping and landing, you're saying feet together, or if they start, but making sure that I can land under some high tension.
Yeah.
Toes touch, kiss the ground, back to the top. I squeeze my butt, open the hip up.
Yeah.
And then
the arms can just stay stable. On the way down, they just stay neutral. But as they hit, they swing back up. Back, front, back, front. Here's another thing that I just realized right now that I forgot to say, actually, is that when a lot of our athletes jump off of the box, we see this. If you look at my feet, as soon as they release, the toe comes out. We see that toe release, and that's another dump. So what I call chasing is this. I'm gonna have my toes, big toes, chase each other. So I'm gonna squeeze my feet together. So when I land, I'm in a little bit more tension, can bounce back up. Chase, bounce back up. That's what we're looking at. So chasing the midline is gonna give you better positioning. So if you catch yourself in a little crappy position, or someone's like, hey, what's going on? You're missing out, or something's just dumping, start chasing.
Start chasing.
Yeah.
Good position means that I need to be prepped to have good ankle mechanics.
Mm-hmm.
Gotta have good range of motion, that my tissues need to be warm. The common tendon of the heel cord is one of the stiffest tissues of the body. It's the strongest tendon in the body. What we find is that it takes a little bit more time to get sufficient blood flow in there. It's like, imagine it's hard-packed earth and you're just fire hosing it with blood. It takes a while for that blood to soak in there and really those tissues to become long. We want our athletes to be really hot and sweaty, and they've spent some time really prepping their posterior chain, open up the front of the hip, that unloads that heel cord, and then I jump with good mechanics, and I got it all day.
You're good to go.
Forza.
Good job.
Go chase this chupacabra. We'll see you tomorrow.
Yep.